Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for that, because mine is really short. I did not do a presentation, purely because I'm highly traumatized. My name is Lerato Mutaung Gobeni. I currently work for Harvard University, and I have a disclaimer, and that disclaimer is I discovered recently that I suffer from what is called the imposter syndrome. Do you know what that is? A lot of women suffer from the imposter syndrome, and to overcome it, I always remember a guiding philosophy of mine that my mother taught me when I was, I think, the first poem I ever learned at 7 years old, and it's about Langston Hughes, who I did not know until I was 15 that was actually male, and that he was also American. And the title of the poem is Dreams, and it goes like this. Hold fast to dreams, for when dreams die, life is a broken-winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, for when dreams go, life is a barren field frozen with snow. And the reason this poem has been a guiding philosophy for me is because my mother, who was my guiding marker in life, passed when I was 14. At 13, I was gang raped by men I did not know. And it was my first experience with self-esteem issues. And then I later discovered that I'd actually been molested when I was 9. And all of these things meant that I had to deal with my identity, who I was, what was I going to do with my life. And when my mother died, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. And for the rest of my life, till today, I struggled with who I was, the impact I was going to have in the world, what was I going to do, despite the fact that I was raised by a strong woman who was a teacher at Morris Isaacson School, and I was always exposed to politics, to social justice, to all of those things that make society better. And I thought that I was going to be a change agent, and I was going to do something meaningful for society. And so when this happened to me, I remember in 1993, when the transitional period was happening in South Africa, and we were in Middlelands, and it was at the time when all of the violence was happening, and I was going to the taxi rank with my mother, and when we were getting to the taxi rank by Zone 3 Middlelands, there was people were shooting. And so I just remember my mom pulling me down and saying to me, run forward, and she stayed behind. She wanted me to survive, and I ran forward and I got home, and I cried because I did not know what had happened to my mom. And eventually she came home. And at that time, I began to have the question in my mind, now 7, 9 years old or so. I asked myself, what was I gonna be? And the first conversation I had with my mother about that, I was in a taxi called Noord. And anyone who is in our age group knows Noord. Né? And I remember saying to her, she asked me what I wanted to be. And there was a man, a gentleman, who had been my parents' friend for a long time. But he was always drunk, always smoking, but seemed to be upwardly mobile. And I asked my mother, what does this man do? And my mother said, this man is a lawyer. And I said, what is a lawyer? And my mother told me what a lawyer was. And then I started to discover Nelson Mandela, all of these people. And I said, I'm going to be a lawyer because I want to be an agent for change. And so I then decided that despite all of my troubles, despite all of my issues, despite no longer having my parents, what was I going to do? And I said to myself, I'm going to study no matter what. If I can't go to school, if I can't pay for school, whatever I was going to do, I was going to do it so that I could go to school. And so my journey was never followed a chronological order. I did not go to school, go to varsity, go to work. It actually happened in a lopsided fashion. And I found a way to have corporates employ me, and then found a way for corporates to pay for my education. And which is why I am standing here today, because when I then got the opportunity to go to the United States after having worked on the World Cup in this country for the Royal Bafokeng Nation, I said to myself, my God, Royal Bafokeng, World Cup, what was I going to do that was going to be grander than the World Cup? You know, and I said it was going to be bigger than that experience. And the experience I had was to go back to school. And I went to study in the United States, and I studied political science. And because I thought I was going to come back to this country and do something, and I'm almost done. But at that, there was a pivotal point in my studies, and it was at the time when we were going through this mayhem with the previous dispensation. And I said to myself, I'm going to go back, because you know why? America has almost 350 million people. They can sort themselves out. We have 50 million. We need to find a way to figure this out. And so I came back home. And when I came back home, I said I'm an imposter, right? I felt like, what was I going to do in this country? I don't know anything. I don't remember anymore about South African politics, because I'm all now in US politics. I know the constitution of the US better than I know my own constitution. And so how was I going to do that? I found Timali online. And I said, where was I going to study something about Africa so I can become relevant in this context? And that's when I came to Timali. And Timali has changed my life in the sense that I did so well, right? Who taught me? I did so well, and I remember having a conversation with my professor to say, what was I going to do next? And he says, have a relentless passion for education, continue. And so because I never got to do this thing that I wanted to do called law, I then decided at the end of last year to say, I'm actually gonna do the thing that I never got to do because no one was gonna support me to do it. I can afford to do it now. And for all of my sins and all of my efforts, which is why I don't have a presentation, is because I am registered for an LLB at WITS and it's kicking my behind, excuse the French. And so to close, I just want to say that there is somebody who really inspired me who said, and this is a quote from the AA. I don't know why, Alcoholics Anonymous. It says that it's all good. It's all good in the end. If it's not good, then it's not the end. And so for me, I know for sure that it's not the end. So if you want to do anything at all, always remember that there is a guiding force much bigger than yourself that will propel you forward to become that which you are intended to become. Thank you very much.